Welcome back. Last time we talked about the life of the Buddha and the experiences that led him to found the religion of Buddhism. This time we'll talk about what those teachings were and what Buddhist people generally believe. As always, when talking about religion, it's important to keep in mind that there are multiple branches of Buddhism, and not every Buddhist believes in exactly the same thing. With that disclaimer out of the way, a very brief reminder from last time. The Buddha's experiences taught him that the correct path to take in life was neither getting every single thing you desired, nor was it correct to go the opposite way and deny yourself everything. The correct way was the middle path between those two extremes. After Buddha spent 49 days meditating underneath that great tree, he believed that he had been enlightened and that he had discovered the Four Noble Truths. The first of these truths was, life is suffering. Buddha had suffered being a spoiled prince, and he had suffered being a poor monk. Life itself consists of suffering. We're starting on a very positive note, right? The second truth is that the cause of suffering is desire. Sometimes the suffering can come from not getting the things you desire, and sometimes it can actually come from overindulging yourself on your every whim. But either way, desire is at the root of all suffering. Now it's time to turn this around, though, because the third truth is that there is a way to end suffering. And that way is the fourth truth. The way to end suffering is the Eightfold Path. Everyone got that? Follow the Eightfold Path and you're all good. Okay, it's been fun. I'll see you next time. Wait. Knowing all that might not help very much if you don't also know what the Eightfold Path is. Well, the Buddha and I have you covered there. As the name would imply, the Eightfold Path has eight parts. Let's look at those. The first part is called the Right View. And it states that actions have consequences. Death is not the end, and actions have consequences after death. In order to walk the Eightfold Path, you must have the correct view of yourself and the universe. Remember in our lesson on comparing and contrasting Hinduism and Buddhism, we talked about how both religions believe in reincarnation, the idea that when you die, you will be reborn back into life again. This is different from the Christian idea of heaven, where after you die, you will go on to some type of afterlife. Instead, Buddhists believe that life is a cycle of being born, living and learning, dying, and then being reborn into life anew. The choices you make in life echo into your future lives, and your eventual goal across many, many lifetimes is to achieve a perfect state of understanding, or enlightenment, often called nirvana. Moving right along, the second part is right resolve, and it means that you must peacefully and willingly give things up. Walking the Eightfold Path must be your own choice, not something that is forced on you by parents, teachers, or anyone else. You must, on your own, resolve to walk the path that will free you from desire. Next up is part three, right speech, which says there is no lying, no rude speech, and no gossiping. To achieve peace yourself, your words must likewise be correct and peaceful. We're at number four, which is right conduct, which means no hurting, no killing, and no stealing. Pretty straightforward, I'd say. To be right with yourself, so too must your actions be right. Halfway done, we come to number five, right livelihood, which calls on you to only have what is needed. You should focus on meeting your actual needs rather than giving in to your desires. You need enough food, clothing, shelter, and similar things for yourself and your family. You can also need things that teach you and enrich your life and your soul, like books and art. Past that, There are so many things in this world that we have been trained to think that we need that are really just desires that weigh us down. In order to end suffering, you must be able to let go of these desires. That leads us directly to right effort, which says you must constantly be on your guard against desire. Making the decision to live with the right livelihood is good, but it's not a one-time decision. You must constantly be on your guard against desire because the world will always keep throwing new desires at you. To help you with right effort, we have Part 7, Right Mindfulness, which teaches that you need to be focused on the here and now. Don't be absent-minded. Guarding against desire requires constant focus, which can only be achieved with right mindfulness. However, being able to achieve right mindfulness can be made much easier by Part 8, Right Samadhi, which is sometimes called right concentration. It encourages Buddhists to learn and practice the four stages of meditation. Going into each of the four is a little beyond the scope of this video, but I have been assured by my Buddhist friends that practicing samadhi regularly helps all the previous parts of the Eightfold Path be much, much easier. Well, that's it in a nutshell. Once again, you can access a completed version of these notes from a Google form using the secret word karma, all lowercase. I've put a link below, as well as one in Google Classroom. As always, please, please shoot me an email if you need any help. And of course, stay safe and stay healthy.